Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm Eureka welcome to Joe Scarborough.
Do you have an Auburn fan? War Eagle.
Thank you so much for being here, and I can assure you that nobody that voted on the Time 100 list is from the Central Time Zone and would have to wake up at 5 a.m. to watch me. Only my mother does that. So, President Arnold, thank you so much for having me here. Chairman Adams, Christine, thank you for your generosity. Professor, thank you as well. My goodness, you sure do pay professors well at Eureka College. I want to hear that story someday. I also want to thank Dr. Henry. The music was beautiful. I grew up in a Southern Baptist church in the Deep South, and at the end of every service, I would hear that arrangement. And it took me back to those days growing up in the Baptist church. And right before we left the service, looked at our watches and made sure that it ended exactly at noon so we'd be first in line at Morrison's. Thank you for those memories. What a great honor it is to be standing here today in front of all of you before Eureka College's graduating class of 2013. I liked how the Reverend said, "We honor you and we free you." Has a good ring to it, doesn't it? I am awed. I really am, by the legacy that binds this special place to some of our country's greatest achievements over the last century. But today, I'm a lot more excited to be talking to a group of people, the men and women of the class of 2013, that have in their hands the ability to help define the outlines of the next great American century. As much as I love Ronald Reagan, as much as I honor him, as much as he influenced my life, and he did in so many ways, I've come here today not to pay homage to that great past or the great past of this college, but instead to address a class that has the ability to bend history in the future. Now, this isn't a responsibility I undertook lightly. I usually don't have a lot of people counseling me, but for this special event, I made sure I spoke with the great communicators around the great communicator, Craig Shirley, who you mentioned, a man who I am sure has written another biography of Ronald Reagan in the time it has taken me to deliver this introduction. Craig told me to make sure that I focused on the glories of Reagan's character. My dear friend Pat Buchanan, he suggested that I address the ominous clouds that now hang low over Western civilization. And Peggy Noonan, perhaps the most eloquent speechwriter of our time, Peggy reminded me in no uncertain terms that I am the only thing that is standing between you and your first celebratory beer, so keep it short, Buster. And I will. It is perhaps a warning that your biggest applause line is when you give it the promise to keep it short. So let me speak quickly. It is important to cling to your faith. Faith in yourself, faith in your country, and faith in your God. We live in a self-absorbed age, the me generation that Thomas Wolfe wrote of when he was talking about the baby boomers, a generation that gave us such culturally destructive forces as Woodstock, disco, polyester, Wall Street greed, and Bill Clinton, has now given way to the culture phenomenons of Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Snapchat. You may want to explain to your parents after this why you want those videos to disappear so quickly, but we'll talk about that later. As Time magazine reported this week, the me generation of the baby boomers has given way to the me generation. It is a generation where every human emotion can be reduced to 140 characters, where every smile becomes captive to a smartphone snapshot, where every mundane task becomes fodder for a Facebook posting. Please, let the word go forth from this day forward. I don't care what your aunt's grocery list looks like, and I don't want to know how your roommate did in fantasy baseball last week. These are things that we can all keep to ourselves. But you, and I'm very serious here, because I do tell my four children, you want to rule the world? Read a book. You have got to shield yourself in the coming years from the blizzard of unrelenting, useless information and ceaseless interactions that interrupt your life every 14 seconds. You have got to find time every week to escape from this frantic, self-centered age that you have been born into and look to find meaning beyond yourself. Faith in the God that was revealed in the Sermon on the Mount is the perfect antidote to the me-ism of our time. A faith focused instead on being merciful, on being humble, on being kind, and doing unto others as you would have them do to you. But even beyond those beatitudes, a faith in God will serve as a buffer against the kind of self-absorption that will make your existence empty and unfulfilling. Cling also to your faith in this great country of ours. Despite all the overwhelming challenges that we face today, and the challenges do seem great, but I've got to tell you, it seems hard to imagine a time more grim or difficult in this country than when Ronald Reagan was sworn in on January 20th, 1981. Interest rates were over 20%. The Soviet Union was on the march. We had been humiliated in the eyes of the world by the Iranian hostage crisis for 444 days. And most alarmingly, too many Americans had stopped believing in themselves and stopped believing in this great republic. Ronald Reagan, one man, bent history. He changed everything because Reagan believed in the greatness of America. And as I was driving into this town, and I was walking across this campus, I understood why. It's like Tocqueville said, America is great because America is good. And when America ceases to be good, it will cease to be great. You see that goodness in Eureka. You see that goodness across America. Ronald Reagan did then, and I do today. Faith in America, and it all started here, was the Gipper's guiding light. It wasn't the punchline in a political speech. And that made all the difference in the world. Reagan liked to quote another Illinois native, Carl Sandburg, who said, "I see America not in the setting sun of a black night of despair ahead of us. I see America in the crimson light of a rising sun, fresh from the burning, creative hand of God. I see great days ahead, great days possible to men and women of will and vision." You know, a few years after becoming president, during an era of malaise, Ronald Reagan told a re-energized America, "We can perform great deeds and take freedom's next step, and we will. We will carry on the tradition of a good and worthy people who have brought light where there was darkness, warmth where there was cold, medicine where there was hunger, and peace where there was only bloodshed. Let us be sure that those who come after will say of us in our time that in our time we did everything that could be done. We finished the race. We kept them free, and we kept the faith. You know, within 5 years, the Berlin Wall, which sits outside a part of it now in a garden, was torn down. The Soviet Empire was in ruins, and 100 million souls had finally been freed from the tyranny of communism. Reagan's critics had been scornful of this Eureka College grad who kept talking about his optimism in America. Some had even predicted World War III. He was a saber rattler. He was jingoistic. He was going to provoke the Soviets into war. Instead, Ronald Reagan's policies gave Americans a sudden end to a twilight struggle that once had grimly held the possibility of a Holocaust. In less than a decade's time, Ronald Reagan's faith in America, his faith in America and its greatness, had paid off. And it's now your time to continue that race, to keep them free, and to keep the faith, your faith in God, your faith in country, and most importantly, your faith in yourself. Because it never gets easier. It never got easier for Ronald Reagan. It's never got easier for me. Let me tell you, I decided to run for Congress when I was 29 years old. Nobody knew who I was. I had no money. I had no name ID. I had no connections. I just had the belief that I had to go to Washington and make America a better place. To tell you the truth, when I knocked on doors, people would say, "Why are you running for Congress?" And I'd say, "Because I want to stop Bill Clinton." I'd see that guy on TV and be like, "I feel your pain." I'd go, "He's lying. You know he's lying." And so when I told my parents that I was going to run against Earl Hutto, a 16-year incumbent in a district that hadn't elected a Republican since 1872, and they had hung the last one they sent up to Washington. It was a tough town. They call it the Redneck Riviera in Northwest Florida, L.A., Lower Alabama. AA, America's Albania. I can go on forever. I went to tell my parents that I was going to run against Earl Hutto because I wanted to stop what was happening in Washington. I thought they'd be excited, right? First of all, they're my parents. I'm entitled to that excitement, right? Secondly, my parents were so conservative, they still think Richard Nixon was framed. So I remember telling my mom and dad in their kitchen, "Mom, Dad, I'm running against Earl Hutto." My dad stared at me, looked down for about 5 minutes, put his hands in his pocket, looked up, and then he said, and I'll remember this as long as I live because my dad passed away a couple years ago. He said, "That's great, Joey, but I'm voting for Earl." Seriously? Right? Seriously? I turned to my mom. I go, "Ma," who's weeping in the corner, "help me here." She says, "I'll vote for you." So I figure, being the optimist, I learned it from the best. Here I am campaigning in a district that hadn't elected a Republican since 1872. I have no money, no name ID. I'm running against a 16-year incumbent in the first house I ran in. I split it right down the middle, 50-50. And I found that year you didn't need your father's vote to win. So I got 62% of the vote, and I went to Washington. But you know what? You would think that would be affirmation. In Congress by 30, I had a TV show by the time I was 40. And even then, I'm in New York City, and I have three strikes against me. I'm conservative, I'm from the South, and I went to a state school. The University of Alabama, and we have an Auburn fan here. I thought you were dressing kind of goofy for Central Illinois. But anyway, people in Manhattan made fun of me because of my alma mater, Alabama. I admit it, I wasn't good in math, but as you know very well, at Alabama, you don't have to be good in math because every year we only have to count to number one. Anyway, roll tide! Roll tide! I don't know if we have any Notre Dame fans in the audience, but my condolences. I just want to assure you that in the Southeast, we play real football and have real girlfriends. Is there a back entrance here, by the way? Ronald Reagan, too. I'm going to go back to my safe zone now. Ronald Reagan as well. You know, one of my favorite speeches Ronald Reagan gave, or at least part of a speech that Ronald Reagan gave, was at a commencement, which, by the way, he borrowed from his 1982 speech at Eureka College, at the commencement there. He went to Harvard, where professors had been mocking him as an amiable dunce for years that didn't have a good enough education to run this country. Reagan stood in front of them. He had the seal of the president right there as he talked to him, and he talked to the Harvard grads and the faculty that sat behind him who had no respect for him or his education, and he said, "You know, sometimes I lie awake in bed at night and I wonder just what I would have accomplished if I had a good education." Remember that. Ronald Reagan didn't have a good education. He had a great education. As I drove in today, as I sat through this ceremony, and as I look at this graduating class that walked through the class of 2013, I can tell you that you didn't have a good education here over your 4 years. You had a great education. So cling to your faith. Cling to your faith in God. Cling to your faith in this great country of ours. Cling to your faith in yourself. And if you do, you will find, like President Reagan, that even in this cynical, self-absorbed age, you can help others, you can make a difference in this country, and you can bend history in this world. So go out now and bend history. Thank you so much.